Oh, good morning, friends. He is risen. Hallelujah. He is risen indeed. It's great to welcome you on this Easter Sunday as we gather together in person. It's great to have so many of you join with us, almost a full house. We almost need to open up the back hall, but it's good to see you this morning. And we welcome those who will be joining in online and from home on DVD and CD later in the week. We pray that as we gather today, as we gather in our homes, that the Spirit of God would fall afresh upon us each in these days. Just one announcement, really, that next Sunday our worship's going to be led by our core mission secretary, Fraser Hunter, and then over the coming weeks, it'll be different members of the core council are going to be leading us in worship because Catherine and I, most likely, I think, won't be here next weekend, because hopefully we'll be welcoming our baby into the world. So please remember us in prayer, but remember as well our core council as they prepare to lead worship over the coming weeks. And so it's great that today on Easter Sunday that we have special guests with us, and it's great to be able to welcome them this morning. I'll let them introduce themselves, we just give them a warm welcome to Perth Salvation Army this morning in our usual way.
Oh, there we are. Yes, can you hear me, Mother? Well, it's very good to greet you this morning. Do you know, I've got to say to you that I haven't liked this way that we happen to be doing meetings over the past year on Zoom. I'm a congregation and platform man rather than technology. You don't seem to get the same reverence and the same atmosphere in worship on Zoom as you can in a meeting in the hall. Well, I am, to introduce ourselves, I am Major Paul Westlake. I'm actually retired, have been for 2 or 3 years, but Lelaine has an appointment at divisional headquarters, and so I'm going to get her to introduce herself as well.
Be with you this morning, and I'm Major Lelaine Westlake, and I have a funny title. I'm called the Dauld, which is the Divisional Officer for Leader Development, and so I try to look after the officers with their training and with their annual reviews and different things like that. So that's my little role at DHQ. I'm enjoying it very much.
Good. Here is the news for Sunday, the 4th of April, AD 30. Jesus Christ is alive. Unconfirmed reports early this morning claimed that his tomb was empty and that he had risen from the dead. These reports have since been confirmed by numerous witnesses who have both seen and spoken to him. No official statement has been made by the Sanhedrin or the Roman authorities, but our correspondent understands that a great deal of diplomatic activity is going on. While the authorities are anxious to deny the reports, they are embarrassed by the fact of the empty tomb and their inability to produce the body of Jesus. The evidence is that he has risen from the dead. Jesus Christ is alive. Now, if ever I say that again during the morning, I want to hear a robust hallelujah, okay? So let's practice it, shall we? Jesus Christ is alive. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. We're going to sing our first song together. No, we're not. We're not going to sing our first song. But I must tell you, there is a song in the songbook which has the line, "How can I keep from singing?" And surely that's true on Easter morning. So I'm going to sing very quietly under my breath, and you can do as you feel led. So our first song, "Christ the Lord is risen today, hallelujah." Shall we stand? Thank you. Amen. You may be seated. I could hear one or two of you, singing just a little bit above your breath, but I'm not going to complain at that. You do what you like. Okay. We're now going to look at a clip on the screen, and it's simply entitled The Empty Tomb. We're told in Scripture that when Peter and John heard that the tomb was empty, they ran to the tomb. John got there first, but he wouldn't go in. But Peter, the impulsive one, when he arrived at the tomb, he went straight in. And we're told they didn't understand that why the tomb was empty and that Jesus had risen. But you know, I think Peter might well have got some inkling of what had happened, because you know that Jesus was a carpenter. Now, when he did his work with wood, he would have a cloth to wipe the sweat from his brow. And at the end of the day, when he'd finished, he would take the cloth and he would fold it in a certain way and put it down. But when the job was actually finished, when he'd finished the actual job, he would fold it in another way and lay it over the job to signify that that job was finished, it was complete. And that's how the grave clothes were probably folded in the tomb. And it could well have been that Peter and John got some inkling that Jesus was saying, it's finished, I've completed my task. He is Lord. He is Lord. He's risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Let's sing that chorus together before we pray. God, we thank you that you make all things new. Thank you for the victory and the power in your name. Thank you that you hold the keys over death. That by your might, O God, Jesus was raised from the grave, paving the way for us to have new life with you. We confess our need for you this morning, fresh, new, again. We ask that you renew our hearts and minds and lives for the days ahead. We pray for your refreshing over us, something we so desperately need in these days that we have been living through over the past year. Keep your words of truth planted firm within us. Help us to keep focused on what is pure and right. Give us the power to be obedient to your word as contained in the scriptures. And when the enemy reminds us where we have been and what we have done, hissing his lies and attacks our way, we trust that your voice speaks louder and stronger, reminding us we are safe with you and that your purposes and plans will not fail. We ask that you will be our defense, our rear guard, keeping our way clear, removing the obstacles and covering the pitfalls. Lord, lead us on to your higher ground. And Lord, I would pray for every individual in this meeting this morning. We are so glad that they have been able to come and share in this gathering for worship. And I pray that as we gather for worship, it will be the inspiration for us all to go out there and be the kind of people you want us to be in the world, the kind of Christians that we want to be and you want us to be, so that we can influence others in coming to the kingdom, in knowing your resurrection power in their lives. Now, O Lord, I just pray that you will bless each item that will take place in this meeting. And may it be that it will be an inspiration to us all for the coming week. Amen. Amen. Now, we're going to bring to you a short drama, and it depicts a courtroom, and there was a questioner and one of the soldiers, and it looks at the different reasons why people wanted to deny the resurrection.
Take this Bible in your hand and please read the card.
I swear by Almighty God that the evidence which I will give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Please tell us your name, soldier.
Falsimus Maximus, sir.
Falsifus Maximus. Oh, never mind. Tell me, were you the chief guard at the tomb of Jesus of Nazareth, who was recently executed for pretending to be the King of Israel?
Yes, sir.
So, ladies and gentlemen, a most valuable witness here to the resurrection of Jesus Christ, a man who was really there, and what's more, he promised he can tell the truth. At last we can hear what really happened. This man must have seen it all. I'm sure we can rely on his testimony. Now, soldier, you said that Falsifus Maximus, you said that you were on guard at the tomb of Jesus for 2 nights after his execution.
Oh, yes, sir, yes.
And what happened?
It was dark, sir.
Yes, it usually is dark at night. What happened on Sunday morning?
Jesus' disciples came along and stole the body from the tomb.
I'm sorry?
Yes, yeah, so were we.
No, I don't mean that. I mean, I don't believe you. How many of you soldiers were there?
20, sir.
20. And you let a bunch of fishermen, unemployed tax collectors, and general riffraff steal a body which you were supposed to be guarding?
Yes, sir.
So, big fight was it then? Lots of people killed, were they?
Oh, no, sir, no.
So how did it happen? Did you just stand there and let them take the body away?
No, sir. It was like, we were asleep, sir.
You were asleep. Do you know the penalty for being asleep on guard duty? What is it? Well, you seem to have survived that very well. How did you avoid? Oh, never mind. Let's try a different question. Perhaps you could suggest why Jesus' friends took his body away.
Well, maybe they wanted to bury him somewhere else, sir.
Well, in that case, why are they out on the streets shouting that Jesus is still alive?
I don't know, sir.
If they know he's dead, why are they still saying he's alive, even though they're in deep trouble with the temple authorities, and a couple of them have already been whipped for persisting in this apparent lie?
I don't know, sir.
Is it likely that they would put up with this if they knew where the body of Jesus was?
No, sir. Well, I mean, they did steal his body, sir. They did, really, honest.
You don't mean that, do you? So, if it wasn't Jesus' disciples who took the body away, who was it? Was it the priests?
No, sir.
No, you're telling the truth this time. If they had the body, they would have put it on show by now and put a stop to this Christianity before it even got started. So was it the Romans?
No, sir.
No, you're dead right there as well. Because if they had taken Jesus' body, they would have put him on display by now as well. My kingdom is not of this world indeed. Let me make a suggestion. Jesus wasn't really dead at all. What he did was, he only fainted. He woke up in the cool of the tomb and started to get out. You superstitious guards thought it was a ghost and legged it. That was it, wasn't it?
No, sir. No, sir. No, it wasn't like that. People don't survive being crucified. Besides, one of the Roman soldiers drew a sword into his side, and just to make sure.
So tell the truth. What was it like?
When we came round, everyone was gone and the tomb was empty. We heard that Jesus' friends were saying that he'd risen from the dead and that they'd seen him alive. I'm beginning to believe it myself, for the priest came along and said that we'd get into lots of trouble if we talked about what we'd seen, and they gave us some money. And they told us to say that we were asleep and that his disciples stole Jesus' body during the night. But that's not true.
So what is the truth then?
Well, Jesus did rise from the dead. Maybe if I'm quick, I could get to see him.
Yes, all right, you can go.
I hope you all caught that. I didn't realise there was a problem with the mic. But we're not going to sing again. We're going to look at the words. And the words of the song this time is, "Low in the grave he lay, Jesus my Saviour, waiting the coming day, Jesus my Lord." Now, we clapped our hands in the first song, and that really wasn't too lively. This one is. So enjoy the chorus, clap your hands, and really lift it up, if not in our voices, then in our hearts. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We're going to join in a United Scripture reading. I'm going to read the first part, and then when we get to, I think it's about verse 10, we're going to join in together. There's a part for ladies, for men, and then all together. So I'll do the first part, John chapter 20, verses 1 to 18. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him." He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen there as well as the buried cloth that had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded by itself, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed. Now please join in the second part. Just read as you are in your normal voice. Will just be great. Thank you. Then the disciples went back to their homes, but Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they've put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize it was Jesus. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it that you are looking for?" "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." "Mary." She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. Amen.
Looking at the screen for a few moments, we're going to take part in a responsive reading. She'll come up on the screen. I will say the first part, and if you will respond with, "He is risen indeed." In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus. He's risen indeed. Jesus has come that we may have life and have it to the fullest.
He is risen indeed.
If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come.
He is risen indeed.
God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him.
He
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen indeed. Jesus Christ is alive.
Hallelujah.
Now come on, that was a half-hearted effort. Jesus Christ is alive.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Now, a few years ago, there was a song written and performed by a gentleman whose name escapes me for the moment, but it was called Hallelujah. And not long afterwards, somebody wrote some Easter words to the song Hallelujah, which we are going to listen to just now.
A crown of thorns placed on his head. He knew that he would soon be dead. He said, "Did you forget me, Father? Did you?" They nailed him to a wooden cross. Soon all the world would feel the loss of Christ the King before. Face up to the sky, said, "I am coming home now, Father, to you." A reed which held his final sip was gently lifted to his lips. He drank his last and gave his soul to glory. Body of our Lord, said, "Truly this was Jesus Christ, our Savior." He looked with fear upon his sword, then turned to face his Christ and Lord, fell to his knees, crying, from his head the thorny crown and wrapped him in a linen gown, then laid him down to rest inside the tomb. The holes in his hands, his feet inside. Now in our hearts we know he died to save us from ourselves. By again they came to move the stone to bless the slain with oil and spice, anointing, hallelujah. But as they went to move the stone, Jesus Christ has risen. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Isn't that a beautiful song? It was a beautiful song when it was first written, but the Easter story makes it even better, doesn't it? We now turn to Scripture again and to the first letter to the Corinthians and chapter 15, and commencing to read at verse 12. But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead. But he did not raise him if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only in this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. May the Lord add his blessing to that reading to us this morning.
We're going to look at one more song before Paul brings God's word to us this morning, and it's that great song, Look Ye Saints, The Sight Is Glorious. So again, you're able to clap your hands and just lift it up to the Lord. Thank you.
You know, this not being able to sing is so awful, isn't it? I have made a resolution. While I was sitting there, I thought to myself, I am going to write to Nicola Sturgeon and Boris Johnson and say, it's about time you allowed us to sing. Who's with me on that one? Good. Virtually, and it's great. Marvellous. Okay. If Christ is not raised, your faith is in vain. You are still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep, believing in Christ, are lost. You know, every now and again, usually about this time of year, magazine and newspaper articles question the validity of the resurrection of Jesus. And not only magazine and newspaper articles, ordinary people in the street talk about it and say, well, of course, it didn't really happen. And I'm also very sad to tell you that there are Christian church-going people who say the resurrection did not happen as it says in the Bible. They say that when the disciples saw him risen from the dead, it was subjective. They knew in their minds, in their hearts, that he had risen, but he hadn't risen physically. And that's what we have to put up with these days. Another argument goes that Jesus, believing he was the Messiah, schemed throughout his life to manipulate people and events so that the Old Testament prophecies would be fulfilled. People would believe he was the Son of God. They assert that the vinegar passed to Jesus was a drug supplied by an accomplice to simulate death. He was revived and claimed resurrection. Another example goes like this. The disciples stole the body, leaving the mystery of the empty tomb. Now, if that happened, the disciples would go around preaching what they knew not to be true. Now, I know, and they would have died for it. Now, I know that people die for some pretty harebrained schemes in this world, but nobody would say that somebody was alive when they knew he was dead and that they had buried him. Such conjecture is not new. During the first century in Corinth, those who questioned the resurrection stated flatly, dead men do not rise again. Paul's response, if you take that position, saying Jesus did not rise again, if that be so, the whole of the Christian faith is futile. 7 times in 8 verses he uses the word if to show the consequences of no resurrection, the inevitable conclusion of those who deny the resurrection is that the Christian faith is phony. The dead have perished and we are pitiful people. No resurrection equals no faith, no forgiveness, no future. Now, Paul uses the word vain 3 times in this passage. It simply means hollow. He says, I preach nothing and you receive nothing. So is the gospel an empty shell, no longer relevant? No, it is not. You only have to look at the changes the gospel has brought about in this world. For instance, children. Before the gospel, infanticide was quite common. Children were of little value. Jesus changed all that. The disciples would shoo children away if they came anywhere near Jesus. Jesus' response, let the children come unto me. You will remember the time when the disciples came to Jesus asking a very silly question. Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And what does Jesus do? He takes a child, saying that unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Why would he say that? Because children are teachable. They are not set in their ways. How many times have you heard in the Salvation Army, well, we've never done it like that before. I've always thought that's a great reason for doing it in a new way. Children are optimistic. They don't have any baggage going back years, and Jesus wants us to be like children. He then goes on to add, if anyone should cause one of these little ones to lose faith in me, it would be better for that person to have a large millstone, notice not just a millstone, but a large millstone, tied around his neck and be drowned in the sea. What about slavery? A very controversial subject in our world these days, isn't it? Now, I know that Paul said, slaves, be obedient to your masters, but there are a number of verses where Paul tells masters to treat slaves fairly and not harshly. In other words, don't treat them like slaves. But the clincher for me is the passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 22 to 24, because Christianity was born in an economy where slavery was an accepted institution, humans buying and selling other humans. And it says, I believe slavery to be condemned by the gospel by the very phrase, God bought you with a price, so do not become slaves of human beings. God bought you with a price, so do not become slaves of human beings. What about the position of women? Another very controversial subject in our society today. Let me tell you, the gospel elevates women. Up to Christ's coming, women had been the pawns of men. Some women would say they still are, but not half as much as they used to be. Jesus gave them dignity. Jesus did away with all gender discrimination with the incident of the woman at the well. Jesus spoke to her, took an interest in her against all the rules. First of all, Jesus wasn't supposed to speak to a woman, and he certainly wasn't supposed to speak to a Samaritan woman. If you look at the account in the Gospels, you will find that Jesus almost teased this woman in this conversation with her. The gospel fostered education. In this country, at first, all education was initiated by Christians. And the first schools in this country were founded by Christian churches. The gospel spawned democracy. Thomas Paine is quoted as saying, democracy is nothing but a political name for the ideals which Christians brought into the world as religion. You see, there are people who say we're not a Christian country anymore in this country because other faiths want to take over. We are a Christian country, I want to tell you, because our laws are based on the Bible. No other writings, the Bible. So quite an impressive record. Christianity vain, hollow? I think not. Second point I want to make is, if Christ is not risen, we have no forgiveness for sin. Paul says that without the resurrection, those who have died with faith in Christ have perished, are destroyed, are in eternal death or ruin. That is the result of sin. The greatest of all tragedies is for the soul to perish. Now, millions of pounds are spent each year on paint and lacquer to keep wood from perishing, on sprays to keep plants from perishing, on monuments and plaques to keep memories from perishing. But God made the ultimate sacrifice, paid the ultimate price when he gave Jesus, his only son, to keep you from perishing by forgiving us our sins. Now, I said this a few days ago when we were conducting a service at the care home, Davidson House, which I work at 3 days a week as the chaplain. And I was saying this, and I say it every Easter, and I'm sure my dear wife will be getting fed up with me with hearing it, but I've been asked on more than one occasion, is there anybody in this world for you, for whom you would die if you had to? And after a moment's thought, I think to myself, well, yes, there are people in this world, perhaps, for whom I would die if that person was going to be saved. Not that many, but there are a few. But you know, there is not one person for whom I would ask my son to die for. But God did it. God did it. You can imagine a conversation between the father and the son. Son, you've got to go down there and you've got to sort out the mess by telling them about the kingdom of heaven and about telling them about me and what I'm like. But I'm afraid it's going to end with a very cruel death for you. God did it. He asked his son to die for our sins. I remember as a 10-year-old watching a film at the army, The Blood of the Martyrs, where communist soldiers entered a meeting and demanded that one person die and the rest would be spared. An officer stepped forward and was shot. It made a very deep impression on me as a 10-year-old, and I thought about it for days afterwards. Well, I probably would if circumstances required it, but there would be no way that I would offer up my son to die for anybody. But God did it, and by his death and resurrection, when we stand before the Lord on the day of the Lord, the word forgiven will be heard. Excuse me. And the last point I want to make. If Christ is not risen, we have no future. Finally, Paul says, if only for this life we have hope in Christ, then we are to be pitied more than all men. And we have denied ourselves for nothing and dedicated ourselves to nothing. The Salvation Army will have been a complete waste of time and energy for those who gave their wealth to its cause. It will have been a complete and utter waste of money. We live in a world where there is much misery and suffering. TV, radio, newspapers, street corner, it's everywhere. But the risen Christ gives comfort to the world's sorrow and hope to the world's despair. You know, tell a person that they've got no hope. Tell a person they've got no purpose or any hope, you will destroy that person. But tell a person there is hope. Tell a person there is purpose. And they will come alive. The risen Christ gives comfort to the world's sorrow, hope to the world's despair, and life to the world's death. A French philosopher told Thomas Carlyle of a new religion he was going to found. There would be no mysteries to it. It would be as plain as possible, based on positivism. Carlyle commended him. Well done, if that's what you want to do. But all he needed to do was to speak as never a man spoke, live as never a man lived, be crucified and raised on the third day, get the world to believe he was alive, and his new found religion might just stand a chance. Everything rises or falls on the resurrection of Christ, for without it we have no faith, no forgiveness, and no future. Now, if we say we believe that Christ is risen, do we not have a responsibility to comfort sorrowing people with the news that he is risen and that he wants to bring comfort? Do we not have a responsibility to bring hope to seemingly hopeless people with the news that he is risen and can bring hope? I've dealt with many alcoholics, drug users, all telling me that there is no hope for them. What a privilege it is to share that Jesus can bring that hope to them, who didn't just die on the cross, but gloriously triumphant rose again. Do we not have a responsibility to take life to those who are dying in their sins? Will we do it? If we believe in the resurrection power of God, we will. Now, listen to this quote from the Reverend George MacLeod, written some years ago. He says, and this has got to be one of the best quotes I've ever heard, "I simply argue that the cross be raised again at the center of the marketplace as well as on the steeple of the church. I am recovering the claim that Jesus was not crucified in a cathedral between two candles, but on a cross between two thieves, on the town garbage heap, at a crossroads so cosmopolitan that they had to write his title in Hebrew and Latin and in Greek, where cynics talk smut and thieves curse and soldiers gamble, because that's where he died and that is what he died about, and that is where church people ought to be, and that is what church people should be about." Now, does that challenge you? Hands up those who are challenged by that. Good. Because that's what we need to do. You see, what I'm seeing at the moment, and have been seeing even before COVID came along, too many of us sitting around in churches, almost amusing ourselves, instead of getting out there as the Salvation Army was supposed to do, and telling people, look, there is hope. There is life. Do you know, far too many Salvation Army Corps have become nothing but warehouses and distribution centres for food for the public. We should be doing that. That is our work as well. But we should also be getting out there and telling people there is hope. There is life because Jesus rose again. Jesus Christ is alive. Amen. Let's turn to our last song, which we're going to share in the words, "O joyful sound, O glorious hour." Hallelujah. Amen. A prayer together. Lord God, you love this world so much that you gave your one and only Son that we might be called your children. Lord, help us to live in the gladness and grace of Easter Sunday every day, Let us have hearts of thankfulness for your sacrifice. Let us have eyes that look upon your grace and rejoice in our salvation. Help us to walk in that mighty grace and tell your good news of hope and life to the world. All for your glory do we pray this, Lord. O Father, let thy love remain. O Son, may I thy likeness gain. O Spirit, stay to comfort me. O Triune God, praise be to thee. Amen and amen.